us, because no CC and the speakers to come join us on the stage. And I must not lie, I've been having heart palpitations because I think I heard somebody say that teachers must be experts in numerals. And I was like, okay, Joma, show me. A foundation phase teacher is teaching home language, ne? Teaching FEL, teaching life skills, and numeracy. I don't understand. Are you expecting me to be an expert on all of those things? So I'm like, okay, maybe you should define what you mean when you say expert, or what is an acceptable level that you think as a teacher I should have to be able to do my job effectively. So I think I'm going to be speaking to people during lunch break just to understand, so you know, I can engage with other teachers on this one.
We are presenting to you Multilingualism in Foundation Phase Maths, and I was triggered by what Prof. Pakeng was talking about when she was talking about languages. And I think I would like to add that being multilingual is rich. It's very rich. It's an asset. An asset that needs to be tempered on as we learn. So our students, our learners are very rich. They bring to classroom very rich understanding of diverse languages of South Africa. And South Africa has positioned itself very well. If you look at our media, it's multilingual. And that's what I embrace and love about South African, because you speak your language, but they understand you, and they speak their languages, and you understand them. So I think that culture has to live in our classrooms too and be embraced as it is embraced in the society. So our colleagues here, one, Lindy Wachuma from Wits University, is going to present to us about multilingualism in foundation phase as well after her. No, we decided that Jabulani starts. Jabulani will start. Jabulani Sibanda from Salt Plateau University. So can I give this opportunity to you, Jabulani?
Thank you very much. It's still good morning to you all.
It's an afternoon, Charles.
No.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it was the right one.
Yeah, no, almost. Yeah. Okay.
thank you very much for the opportunity. I am not in numeracy at all. I have a phobia for numbers. As we embark on this very noble journey of trying to employ all the ranges of languages that we find in our classrooms. So there is a very unsettling finding from research that, especially within the urban areas, the linguistic practices of learners show a complete disconnect with what policy prescribes as the ideal multilingualism. So we have a challenge. The multilingualism which policy describes is not the multilingualism that our learners actually embody. And then what is the challenge with that? Then that may then explain why the traditional approaches to teaching still persist. Why again we end up with trying to be multilingual through monolingual practices. So monolingual is one language. So we use monolingual practices to try and get to multilingualism. And so from this unsettling finding, that's where now I want us to trouble some concepts to say, what is really multilingual in our multilingual classrooms? So the first question we need to try and address is, who are multilingual learners? And generally, they are defined by their proficiency or they are developing proficiency in multiple languages. And the first question to ask then is, can we really define our foundation phase learners as multilingual, going by this definition? First, have they developed proficiency in multiple languages? Which ones? And where does English fit in? And they have just started with their home languages. At what level is their English developed to merit considering them as multilingual? Those are hard questions to think about. Or are they in the process of developing proficiency in the multiple languages? And where exactly are they? Another definition would be the coexistence or contact or interaction of different languages at the social and the individual level. So there are scholars who want to separate multilingualism from plurilingualism. So multilingualism is what South Africa is. Multilingualism is what Gauteng is, what a school is. But does the school or the national multilingualism translate to the multilingualism of the individual learners? So plurilingualism refers then to the individual. If an individual has capacity in many languages, then they are plurilingual. And as we get into our classroom, have we checked whether our learners are essentially plurilingual? I always have a problem with this word. This is testimony that this term is difficult. It even affects GPS signals. So we have to confirm that we have plurilingual learners within our classroom. Otherwise, we start teaching South Africa. We start teaching Gauteng. We start teaching the school and miss out the learner. So we need to establish the plurilingual nature of our learners. They are plurilingual. In which languages are they proficient? And coexistence suggests occurring simultaneously. It also suggests harmony in the languages. Do our foundation phase learners have the languages that qualify them to be plurilingual, so that then we can deploy the pedagogies that Lindiwe is going to talk about, which address multilingual context? So the linguistic resources from multiple languages, does that define the foundation phase classroom as we have it? Do foundation phase learners draw on these resources, or they just know 3-4 languages but are never allowed to draw on these resources? And if they do, in which ways do they draw from these resources, and in what proportions? Don't we have languages which dominate, and so on? And then what do we say then about the voluminous body of research that attests to the effectiveness of mother tongue-based multilingual education, where we say, let's give our learners education in the languages that they are comfortable with, in their own languages? And even the curriculum documents, they indicate that in the foundation phase, we use mother tongue, the learners' home languages. And how does that then speak to the multilingual nature of our learners in the foundation phase? It's easier to talk about deploying multilingual resources in the intermediate phase upwards, because now English is also coming into the picture, and the learners have already sufficiently developed their own languages. So the other challenge that we then face is multilingualism speaks to 3 or more languages. two languages, we talk bilingualism. And the challenge that we have is literature and research doesn't have the models to talk about multilingual education. They have models for bilingual education. There is literature on bilingual education, assuming that the languages are just two. But when we talk about multilingual, we are expecting more than just two languages. Some hypothesis, just to trouble and get an understanding of what kind of learners do we have in the classroom. So there is what they call the linguistic interdependence hypothesis by Jim Cummins, the same guy who gave us Biggs and Kalb. And he says languages are essentially the same. There is not much difference in language. IsiZulu and Setswana, they are just the same, according to Cummins. How? Because they have the underlying, deep down, they come from the same place. What we see as the differences are just the surface features, the vocabulary, the this and that, but essentially all languages have the same base. So they are just like tips of an iceberg. So if you see two tips of an iceberg, you can't then say I'm going to go in between those tips, because deep down the iceberg is covering both the tips. And so Cummins then says once learners are proficient in one language, then they transfer that proficiency to another language, and then it becomes easier. Then again, the question comes back to say, in the foundation phase, if our learners are sufficiently developed, even in their home languages, for them now to be able to transfer whatever they know in their home languages into other additional languages, as we employ the multilingual resources. And then we have what they call the separate underlying proficiency, where the assumption is that in the mind of a learner, what we have are two languages. So if we are talking multilingualism, we are talking about three, four or so languages. So in the mind of the learner, we have two, three languages. But these languages are separate. Setswana is sitting in some corner of its own. IsiZulu is in some corner of its own. English is in some corner of its own. So they are stored separately. And the moment you increase use of one language, because you only have capacity, particular capacity, if you increase the use of one language, then the other one automatically diminishes. That's your separate underlying proficiency. And the teacher who is guided by this understanding will then employ language resources differently in the classroom. Then the common underlying proficiency, which is supported by the linguistic interdependence hypothesis, would then say, if you have two, three languages, they are not taught separately. They are kept in this one block that the mind keeps as language. So you don't have to engage the IsiZulu gear when you want to use IsiZulu, because they are kept in the same box in the mind, and they just have different outlets, but they are kept in the same place. They are merged and do not function independently of each other. And then again, it depends on which perspective we subscribe to. If we subscribe to the common underlying proficiency one, then it means we allow the learners to use whatever languages they want to pick and choose from that box, because they only have a box with languages. If there are three languages, if there are four languages, they are stored in that box, and they are just taking whatever they want. So if they want to code switch, maybe
in the middle of a sentence intrasententially, then they can do that. If they want to take this word and mix it with this and that, they are free to do that because they are drawing from the same box. So linguistic interdependence then says the learners have languages which they have mastered, and those languages they have mastered will allow them to transfer the competence to the other new languages. So if a learner knows language, they know that there is a way of referring to past time, there is a way of referring to present time, there is a way of referring to future time. Those are the common underlying things. It's just the words, the labels, that then make the things different. Another hypothesis from the same guy, the linguistic threshold hypothesis then says, yes, learners can transfer their knowledge from one language to the other language, but provided, one, they have developed their first language sufficiently to a particular level, that allows them then to transfer. So if you have the minimum, if you have the minimum balance in your bank account and you want to transfer money to someone, then you can't. Why? Because your threshold is too low. That's what Cummins is saying. So you need a big enough threshold, a big enough competence in your first language, so that you have things to transfer to the second language. But even then, in the second language where you are transferring whatever you are transferring, you need also to have some understanding, some threshold in that new language for the transfer to be effective. So then if we look at C, limited bilingualism, if you have low level of proficiency in both languages, then there is nothing to transfer. There is nothing to transfer from the first language. There is nothing to act as a foundation for receiving whatever is transferred in the second language. Then we have a problem. We can't then deploy the multiple resources in the classroom. If the learners have not reached some sufficient threshold, then there are negative cognitive effects. Then if you are a partial bilingual, then you have native-like competence in one of the languages. So we are saying you have some understanding of three, four languages, but you have a language which you are very competent in. Then you are at a partial bilingual. Then you can transfer a bit of the things. But then if you have high level of proficiency in both languages, then transfer is easy. And again, it comes back then to the classroom to say, where are my learners as bilinguals? Otherwise, we end up teaching numeracy, or we end up teaching the curriculum, or we end up teaching Gauteng, and then we miss the exact learners which we have in our classrooms. So there are some notable quotes, and I liked the fact that Prof has already covered some of these as she was doing her opening address, to say a bilingual is not two monolinguals in one. So a bilingual is not two monolinguals. What are two monolinguals? Monolingual is knowledge of one language. So if I have knowledge of isiZulu, I'm monolingual in isiZulu. If I have knowledge of English, I'm monolingual in English. And a bilingual is not someone who has knowledge of isiZulu and knowledge of English. That's the example she was giving, to say, if you are good at high jump, and you are also good at running, it doesn't then make you able to do, what was it that she was saying? Headling. Yes, headling. You can be number one on the track for running, then you can be number one for jumping and be very poor at headling. Very possible. The example was quite fitting. That's where now you have two monolinguals. The person knows English, the person knows isiZulu, but they can't combine those two to come up with a bilingual to function as bilinguals. And so we have a lot of people now being bilinguals through monolingualism, which I think is not the focus of this Indaba. And some people just have multi competence, knowledge of more than one language in the same mind or in the same community. It again doesn't translate to multilingualism. And sometimes what then is multilingualism? It's not the use of all the languages that you know. But a multilingual should be able to pick and choose, should be able to function in such a way that we can tell that all these languages are coming from the same box. The person is comfortable with deploying them as they see fit. I won't belabor this one. This one just shows to say there are several models that talk about how learners access meaning in relation to the languages that they know. And again, it will depend on which model you subscribe to. Some say they access meaning through the first language direct to meaning, sometimes through the second language direct to meaning. Some say, no, you go via the first language. Then you access meaning. Others say, so you see, A says there is no relationship between the two languages. The two languages access meaning independently and separately. They do not relate. That's how A differs from C. C is saying the two languages also relate. B is saying you can't access meaning direct through the L2 if you are still learning the language. You have to go via the L1. That's why then you need sufficient understanding of the L1 and some sufficient understanding of the L2. D is now saying there is a lot of asymmetry. Again, it is up to us to decide what do our learners look like? How do they understand meaning? Let me end with this one. Then we have some good news. This should be Chomsky, who tells us that there is a critical period in which learners can acquire as many languages as they want to acquire. Then it gives us hope that our foundation phase learners can really be multilingual. Because from the age of 0 to the age of 6, they say they have a biological predisposition to the acquisition of language. And it's strongest between age 0 to age 6, and then it starts atrophying or it starts diminishing by the age of puberty. When you start to learn a language after puberty, it's now quite difficult to acquire a language. But what they need is a lot of input in the languages for them to be able to acquire the languages. I will stop here and then we'll get to hear the actual practical application of the multilingualism in the classroom from the next presentation. Thank you very much.
I think it's afternoon now, so good afternoon, colleagues. Confirmed, it's afternoon. Mine is a very simple task this time because I'm speaking after giants have spoken. So I'm just pulling through a few examples here and there to give us the mainly the pedagogical strategies that we can use. My focus is on using language as a resource in multilingual settings. And I'll start by looking at the international and local research that has been done so far regarding the use of language as a resource. We'll also look at why do we want to think at language as a resource. Why is it important? Why should we do that? And the last part would be about the strategies that we can use as teachers to guide our learners. And I'm not so sure if I'm still safe to call the learners multilingual after the previous speaker here, because we've just been informed that there's no such thing as a multilingual grade R learner. But anyway, I'm not sure. The speech that we had earlier made it very clear. We've got policy stipulation that says we need to be teaching foundation first learners in 11 languages. So the policy is very clear, it's promoting multilingualism. But what is happening on the ground, maybe it's different. The implementation of this policy that we have been given, maybe it's translated, I've two options here, but I'm sure there is a spectrum of options that are in between, so I'll just highlight these two. We've got the first one where we know that English dominates, and we know that English is a source of power. It gives us access to a different lot of other things. We then get choices made to say we are going to immerse the learners into straight for English, right from the foundation phase level. And one of the reasons driving this is because there's a notion that teaching in English is the best. We don't know. We then get, I think this has also been alluded to, where we talk of some version of multilingualism, which is actually monolingualism. And Ingrid has actually written a lot about this, to say we've got a notion of multiple monolingualism, where we have, in school A, we've got 5 different or 10 different languages, home languages in a foundation first class, but we choose to teach in isiZulu. In school B, we choose to teach in Setswana. So we are practicing monolingualism in all these different schools, but it's multiple monolingualism. It's a wrong interpretation of what is intended to be. So like I'm saying, I just picked two examples here, but there could be a very wide range that's of options which are there. All that this is saying is we've got policy stipulation, but what is happening on the ground might not be exactly what the policy intended. Is it because we don't understand policy? Is it because there's something that stops us? Or maybe it's because of the political reasons that were mentioned earlier. This then leads us to the gaps that are there in the classrooms. There's very little recognition of the proficiencies that the learner brings into the class. And I also want to think that maybe there's very little support maybe for the teacher who want to promote multilingualism in their classroom. Maybe even the classroom environment itself does not even allow for that, before we even talk about the politics that is outside. And as a result, we've got systematic suppression of the learner's home languages. Whether that's a good thing for them or a bad thing for them, we'll soon find out. There's a lot of research that has been done which states that the different competences that the learners bring into the classrooms can actually be used as a resource. They can be tapped on. They can assist them. I'll go to the different researches that have been done. We've had earlier on about the research that was done by Adler, and her take on this is that language is a cultural resource. Language is available, just like time. We all have 24 hours in a day. It's available, therefore it makes sense that we make use of it. We use it in the classroom for the benefit of the learners, maybe for the benefit of the teachers as well. We have this notion that language is a right, language is a problem, language is also a resource. A right, because the Constitution says everybody must be taught, has a right to be taught in the language that they understand. Fair and fine. We go back to the stipulations that are there, but maybe the implementation being different. The problematic part is what we mentioned earlier. when we then don't recognize the different competences in the classroom, then it's a problem. When we then think a learner who's speaking 5, 6, 7 languages is not able to learn mathematics, then we have a problem. So one of the ways of dealing with this problem then becomes turning this around and trying to use the different languages that are there in the classroom as a resource. The next piece of research goes beyond the use of, vocab. I think I can even use myself as an example. When I was in the classroom, I made sure that the learners have a book where they are writing the new words. Every day you check them, but is that all? Is that all that we should be assessing learners on? Is it just the compilation of these new words? Can we not use the different ways that they try to express themselves in the classroom to assess whether they are understanding the mathematical concepts? Can we not use their intonation? Can we not look at the way that they use the mathematics manipulatives in the classroom to check whether there is some understanding that is taking place there? So in this case, the learner's home language is one of the resources, but not the only one. We then look at sources of meaning, and in this case, we are trying to shift slightly from just looking at language as a resource, but to say, what kind of resource is this? A resource that is actually going to bring meaning into the mathematics classroom. So it goes to, when I'm responding to my teacher in class, I'm responding to other learners, maybe contributions, a question that has been asked. It's not just about what I am saying at that particular moment. It's about what has been said in this context when we're discussing this mathematics word problem, for example. So we're now shifting to a resource that actually brings meaning. The last part, or maybe the one that I looked at, I'm not saying these are the only ones. Sorry, there's more. The last part gives us the spectrum between monoglossic and heteroglossic approaches. The monoglossic, I'm not going to repeat it because that's what we talk about when we talk about monolingualism. The heteroglossic brings more languages, more voices. It's multiple of them. We bring them into the classroom. And maybe while we're looking at all these different researches, the thread that's running across is, first, we're using language as a resource, one, but for what reason? For making meaning. That's the key thing. Now, let me go to some problematic situations that may arise in a classroom because of language. I'm not going to go through each one of these one at a time, but I mean, we can read about them. There are words which are ambiguous in our mathematics classroom. Let me quickly go to an example. The list that I have, all of them can be sources of confusion. We know that when I say 5 minus 2, the answer is 3. I'm talking about difference, talking about even, talking about smooth. It's a property which is called polysemy, the examples that I gave earlier. But let me bring it to a multilingual classroom. We've got words such as this one, ngang siti phezulu, in a mathematics language, I mean a mathematics classroom. It can be interpreted in two different ways. I could be talking about phezulu ngisicho more than. I could be talking about phezulu ngisicho above or on top, phezu kwefridge. So do we have teachers who can identify this and be able to manage it in the classrooms? We don't know. The key thing is we need to make the mathematics classrooms meaningful for the learners. I mean, I just gave one example there. We spoke about the words that give us problems, but the key thing is identifying those words and also making sure that we make the learners understand them and also exposing them to the different meanings that they may have. We do have gifted learners in mathematics. It's important as a teacher to actually identify a gifted learner and be aware when they can't express themselves correctly. Because then if we focus on the bad language use or incorrect language use, we miss the mathematics that could be developing there. We had perspectives that talk about contextualizing, using themes that learners are used to. So those are some of the ways the learner's language then comes in, because language and culture are related. We also spoke about the use of heteroglossic approaches, and I'm going to borrow, I know we used this slide earlier on, I'm going to borrow this slide from the earlier presentation, and I'm not going to focus on everything else that we have there. There's research, recent research that has been written about the use of the urban Lokshin lingua. So we are allowed to use slang in the maths classrooms. As long as I'm not focusing on the bad syntax, as long as I'm not focusing on the irregularity, but my focus is on the meaning, I could maybe use a word that's not so, you know, we have picked from two different languages, but if it is going to convey the meaning, remember one of the approaches was, let's not focus too much on the words. Let's focus on mathematics. Some parts we have spoken about, so I'm going to leave, but if I'm to go into a classroom in Hillbrow now, I'll find Swahili, I'll find all sorts of different languages. Without being monoglossic, maybe I can try to use the different, ask Elena to speak in the language they speak with at home. Ask them to say something, but remember to bring them back. Spanda spoke about the use of different approaches, the code switching, etc. Let me give this example here. This is from some of the teachers that we work with, and the teacher was testifying that I have used code switching in my classroom and it has worked. So the teacher writes about, I did have a learner who was closer speaking, comes into a classroom where I'm teaching in Sesotho, and I helped them, and it's giving them positive results. But anyway, from this part, I think what is key is to understand that in as much as we've been having code switching for quite some time now, we've got other strategies, other approaches which are overtaking code switching. So one of the approaches that seem to be gaining a lot of traction, and this is also supported by research, is translanguaging. So it's important that we create those opportunities for learners to actually translanguage, use their languages, and we bring them back to the meaning that we intend. But what's also key to note here is, let the transition between the languages not be imposed by the teacher, because then we're taking away the learner's independence. Maybe what we need to do as teachers is to create the platform, create the opportunities that will allow them to actually do the transitions in between. Is my time up? Okay. We can't ignore the reading part. Whether I'm using Chitsonga, I'm using Chivenda, the learner should be able to read it. So we can't ignore and say we're pushing mathematics. Remember earlier on we've been talking about, don't forget the mathematics ability, but it has to be readable. They have to be able to at least read it so that they can get the meaning. Language use in the classroom, that also talks to questioning. We can look at examples like, what kind of questions am I asking them? Am I allowing them time to respond? Am I allowing them time to verbalize their mathematics thinking? Am I allowing them time to think about the concepts first before they respond? So all those kind of opportunities that the teacher or the environment that the teacher finds themselves in, they need to be nurtured in such a way that there is a platform for that learner to actually verbalize what they're thinking. And what's also important is learner talk. let's create those opportunities for them to talk about the theorems, talk about the mathematics concepts, and that way they get to understand more. I'll leave us with this quotation here, and thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much. We have these two presentations, the one coming from the linguistic side and the other from the mathematics education practices. And from the linguistic side, as we were listening, we might have little understanding of what multilingualism is. And there was an emphasis on proficiency. And from the mathematics side, I heard very clearly that we want proficiency in mathematics. And for me, then I was in the middle and saying, okay, what is it actually that we would like to achieve? But I also heard from the mathematics education side that the learner should tell us how to achieve it. She said, do not impose, but let the, especially at foundation phase, that opportunity is there for the learner to drive how they learn, how they conceptualize, how they make meaning, how they bring things together within this multilingual space they find themselves in. There's also a talk about bilingualism, especially in South Africa, you'll find provinces that are dominated by one African language, and then there, bilingualism happens.
Lindy, where, if I'm correct, I did hear you say that the teacher should not impose the code switching or you know, something along those lines, mm-hmm. and should let the learners, let it come from the learners. Now, I want to know that how do you expect the learners to know that it's okay to use my home language in this class, even though that is not the lot of the school? Because surely the teacher has to model something for the children to see that, oh, this is actually okay to do. Hmm. So that's the first thing, okay? The second question I have, and I'm sure many people have heard me speak on this a few times, is that we know the research that says children develop conceptually much better if they learn in their home language in the formative years, mm-hmm. right? I'm not sure if that is based on research that's done in South Africa or if it is based on research done in other contexts of multilingualism, okay? But whenever I ask colleagues in the research space, Black African colleagues who push for the multilingualism and all the terms, I'm gonna be honest, that's not my, a field that I am, you know, focused on in maths education. Mm-hmm. But every colleague, even the lecturers who taught us this at university, I ask them, does your child go to a school where she is taught in an African language from grade R to grade 3 and then switch to English in grade 4? And I tell you, not one. Not one. Okay? So we, who are seen as the experts, we are pushing this agenda based on research, and that's good. I mean, it's great. But we don't put our money where our mouths are. Mm-hmm. So we all know, so my manager, Dr. Tony Essien, Prof. Tony Essien, who can't be here today, he was actually my lecturer at the time. We were dealing with language in maths, you know, in our master's class. And I asked this question, my colleague, Dr. to Leila is here today. She was there. I said, let's just ask in this class, 99% black African. I said, whose children goes to a school where they learn in their mother tongue from grade 1 to 3? Not one. Even the lecturer himself. What was so lovely was, you know, perchance I came across an article he wrote in one of the magazines where he said, you know, one of my students asked me this question and I had no answer. I didn't know what to say. He says, but having thought about it, I now know why my child does not go to a school where she is taught in her home language, even though she is black African. It's because the language has not been developed enough.
Yes.
To the point where scientific and mathematical and all of those beautiful, you know, statements and whatever, it hasn't been developed to that point where, you know, you can mathematically talk in Zulu about whatever big stuff there is to talk about. And I thought to myself, if that's the reason, then it's okay for the black poor child to go and learn in a home language that hasn't been developed to include scientific and mathematical terms. That is all I want to ask. What do you say to that, Lindiwe? Both questions. And by the way, if you have children, where do they go to school?
There is a question from this one. It's
hallelujah.
The second one.
I wanted a way to articulate what she was asking in a way that you could practicalize. And I think she got to the core of what it is I wanted to ask. I'm on the field every day, almost every day, and I am dealing with a situation where there is no transition from home language to English in going into intersen phase. It's a big mess. It's a mess. And the very same teachers who are on the ground, who should be doing these wonderful concepts you were just speaking about, of which the first time I'm hearing these terms today, so yeah, are not implementing them with their 80 plus learners in the class. And it's an issue of, yes, it's wonderful. Oh, let me encourage you so that you're able to, you know, you can speak in your language. No, this is what I'm saying. This is what I'm trying to get across. Are you getting it or are you not getting it? Let's get this class over and done with. So I want to understand, this is my question. What is the point? Where are we trying to get with this home languaging concept in foundation phase? Because it's not being implemented after from grade 4 onwards. And those very same learners, comprehension is dololo. There's no comprehension for English, for maths, for anything whatsoever. The very same people, when you go into, are finished going into their matric, now going into varsity, lack of understanding. So lack of everything that you are trying to implement now in foundation phase. So how is this going to work going in from foundation to intersen, going into high school, going into varsity? It worked for Afrikaans, yes, they had time. They had 100 years or 200 years because they imposed it through apartheid so that they could have their universities in Afrikaans. And when you get a job, I'd still force that I do my interview and my writing in Afrikaans and finalize it like that and go into my workplace and still speak Afrikaans. I can't do that in Gachivenda. You don't even know what I'm saying. Thank you. Thank you. I'm reverting back to, I'm done. I'm reverting back to.
We are running out of time, colleagues. If you can just ask the question so that we can.
Do you understand my question or my feeling?
Your feeling, what is I do, but not the question.
What is the point? Where is this going?
Okay.
Chair, you can call me out of order because I don't have a question.
Okay.
But I'm really concerned about the question. Well, actually, that's not true. Maybe I'm actually excited by the questions that have come up. And I think it shows you how far we've come in that finally we're having some really emotional conversations about these questions.
It's emotional.
But I'm worried that we might not have time to unpack this carefully, and people... So let me just say quickly that I think in order to understand this question deeply, we have to spend much more time understanding the dual system that we live in. And I think sometimes in these kind of contexts, we forget that we live in a country where we have two universes of schooling in one country. Why do all, I bet all of our kids go to an English-speaking school? And Samantha, I don't think that answers the question at all. Everybody in this country who has the money to get your child into a top quintile school will do so. And because of that, there is a specific sociolinguistic context for all learners that give them a fighting chance to learn through isiXhosa. And those, the three differences are primarily in access to high quality ECD in English, the fact that teachers' first language is English, and even more so than any of that, the dominant language on the playground is English. Children from 0 to 12 learn a second language primarily in the playground, primarily not through formal teaching. In the rest, so that represents a little bit over 20% of our country. In the rest of the schooling system, up to 70%, we have schools, and I know we need to, by the way, I'm really appreciating the complexity that's put forward, but sometimes I think we need to simplify it. And particularly for rural and peri-urban South Africa, you have one African language spoken in the classroom, in homes, and by teachers in the tea room that make for an entirely different teaching and learning arrangement. So the fact that kids are learning, by the way, in that arrangement, I think you can read some of Stephen's work, is the schools in that arrangement who choose English are failing worse than the schools in those areas that choose the mother tongue. Why are we struggling with mother tongue? Because we haven't invested in it. We're extremely ambivalent as a country around 60% of our children. The most important resource that a child brings to grade R is the language that is meaningful. Doesn't matter what language that is. And mathematical is not about using numbers. It's about finding the instructional sentences that kids to imagine and create a mental map of concepts. So for example, in English, when I share equally between two children, each child gets half. We haven't developed that instructional narrative for our teachers. So I think we could talk about this for a long time, but until we understand the division and why some kids are winning and some kids are failing, and our complicity in the way that plays itself out, it's very difficult to answer the kind of questions that came up just now.
Thank you. The last one here, please.
We are pushing towards translanguaging or multilingualism or whatever, but what is it that you are doing in our institutions, in our universities? Do we allow them to present or learn using multilingualism in that classroom? Do we have that capacity, or does it happen? That's the main question that I have.
I think we do have evidence that what we're teaching in universities is not necessarily filtering through to the classroom. We continue teaching in English, and we continue leaving the student teachers to figure it out. How am I going to do this in the classroom? Is it the student teacher's problem? I don't think so. But I think it's the teacher education that needs to be addressing that. The good thing is, I think that information is out there, but they're starting to work on it. And it won't be done in a day. It won't be done overnight. Up until, maybe what's happening now is just creating an awareness. When you go into a foundation phase classroom, go and do 1, 2, 3, without actually practicing it in the actual university lecture hall. But we do have other universities that have started that, like UKZN has started actually teaching foundation phase courses in the mother tongue languages, and they're experimenting on that. So there's work that's being done there. But it will take time. The second question, I'll adopt Tony's answer there. I don't know what the answer is. But the key thing is the dual system exists, like what has been said, and we can't ignore it. And language has always been political. We can't run away from that. When I've got my money, I'm going to take my child to a school, and I'm going to be part of these parents who are going to vote for actually having English being taught from grade R after having known all the languages, I mean, the benefits. Because like we're saying, in this age that we're in, the fact that we still want to use to be monolingual, this is the illiteracy of this stage. Mm-hmm. It's not about us thinking about illiteracy is not being able to read or not being able, we passed that stage. We are now at this form of illiteracy, of us thinking that just learning in English is all that is there. There's vast research which indicates that there are benefits of learning in different languages. There are benefits of being multilingual. There are benefits of learner actually thinking about the mathematics in their language before they can actually try to express themselves, etc. But because of this dual system, and also because of the fact that languages have not been developed, there are indigenous languages, they have not been developed to the same level as the English. When you've got the money, what are you going to do? Take them to where the language is developed. And there could be also a reason to say, maybe we're not investing enough in that African child who's going to mduba-duba and get into a classroom and all they have is just a torn and tattered book. And because we don't want our children to go there, we'll take them elsewhere. But we also don't want to invest there. I'm not sure who's supposed to be doing the investment, but something needs to be done there. If nothing is done, if we don't preach multilingualism, if we don't actually encourage this use of different languages, it means we are going to continue with this divide, and we are going to make sure that school is going to be... the last question. Sorry, I need to take some water.
Education systems normally run on two wrong trajectories. The first one is where you do monolingual practices. Then you teach your grade R to grade 3 in Isindebele. Then you expect that by some miracle, as they move to grade 4, they will be able to learn in a medium which they haven't even developed right from grade R. Then that's why we have what they call fourth grade slump, where you find that learners do well in the foundation phase. The moment they get to grade 4, they drop. Because the system didn't give them the tools that they would need as they transition to grade 4. As they transition to grade 4, texts are starting to get conceptually heavy. The subject areas are getting more, and you are now reading to learn rather than learning to read that you were doing in the foundation phase. So it's a disaster. The system where you say grade R to 3, home language, grade 4 onwards, first additional language. Where are they getting the tools in the first additional language to be able to function from grade 4? Then another extreme end would also then be to the other extreme would be to, so that one, the problem with that one is to assume that because they were doing all they are learning in isiZulu, they are just going to transfer what they know about isiZulu to English. And yet for them to be able to transfer, that's the theory I was talking about, they need some threshold, they need some knowledge of English. They need knowledge of, so they need much knowledge of isiZulu, but they also need some knowledge of English. Then the transfer can happen. But as it is, we are taking our learners, by the moment they get to grade 4, there's nothing to transfer. It's a disaster.
Okay, thank you. Okay, well, this is a serious debate that we need to attend to. Maybe we need to look at having a seminar on multilingualism. I've got quite a lot of I could share through my observations, my research and all that, but what I would like to say to the questions that were coming there is that no one is strong enough to learn another language if they are weak in their own language. Go read. The most powerful people we have now in the world are the Chinese, because they they are focused. They are not like us. They are not like this. We are making noise. We really fumbling. They focused, and also the Koreans, because they took a decision that our identity is what will make us successful. And therefore, they focused on enriching and enhancing their languages to empower their own children, and everything is learned in their languages. They hitchhike English. Wherever they go, they need to learn it, and it's not their priority either. They have tools to translate, to understand what we are saying, but their identity, they are strong and grounded, and they are even economically leading. I'm leaving you with that as you go for the debate. I am not giving up. I have designed an illustrative dictionary for my isiXhosa learners. I made a focus and I made it my agenda that I'm not leaving this because I see the power in it. I designed a dictionary which is well done in English. When you are comfortable with your English, you will learn from it. It's not a dictionary like a translating one. It's more a conceptual building dictionary because I did it for isiXhosa students. And I'm proud in the Eastern Cape, this year we are going to even have isiXhosa exams at matric. So, I'm not giving up. I'm not listening to the noise as an African researcher in mathematics education, because I know the power of understanding your own language and be proficient in it. I know what it does for you. It breaks boundaries. When you don't have your strong native language, you have nothing to rely on. Thank you.